for having invited me to give this ACTA lecture. It's a great honor for me to be here today. And I will also say today is the last Congress day, and I will congratulate the whole Congress organizing committee for this Congress for a very successful event. It has really been a pleasure to attend this Congress. It's also a very special experience for me to be here in Malmö as an anesthetist. I lived and worked in Malmö for many years ago, 40 years ago in 1977. And as a young doctor, I had my basic clinical training at Malmö University Hospital. At that time, the name was Malmö Almene Sykehus. It was before it was merged with Lund University Hospital. And when you were working at Malmö Hospital, the enemy was Lund. A part of my basic clinical training was 2 months in the anesthetic department in Malmö, and it was an exciting experience. I made a specialty where you needed both head and hands, and from the first day I decided to become an anesthetist. And don't worry, I'm not going to tell you my whole life story, but after 2 years in Malmö, including the 2 months in the anesthetic department, my family and I, we moved back to Denmark, to Esbjerg at the west coast. I came to the anesthetic department, and the consultant, they asked me about my skills in anesthesia. I said that they are very limited after 2 months, but I'm well trained in giving epidural anesthesia. Epidural anesthesia, they said, we don't use it here. And I was young and I was enthusiastic, and I made a phone call to Malmö and asked them to send me some of the equipment for epidural anesthesia, the catheter and the needles and so on. And the equipment arrived to Esbjerg by post, and I suggested that we started with epidural anesthesia. Silence in the conference room, no happiness, no smiles. And finally, one of the consultants took me aside and said, "Else, don't you understand? We don't want epidural anesthesia. We are dependent on nurse anesthetists, and epidural anesthesia is only for doctors." I have to say that epidural anesthesia was introduced in the department very soon after I left, and and the anesthetic department at Esbjerg Central Hospital was an excellent place for training anesthesia and intensive care. So, the title of my lecture includes two different topics, and I will explain the background for choosing the first topic, anesthesia in women. There are many well-known differences between men and women in their response to anesthesia, but I was interested in anesthesia to small children, to small girls and boys. Are there differences between them, girls and boys? And the background for this question was publications from a Danish-British research group. They have unexpectedly found harmful effects of some large vaccination programs for children, small children, in Guinea-Bissau in Africa. This topic is far away from my expertise, and I will not go into details with the research. Only briefly mention that one of their main findings are that DTP vaccinations seems to be associated with a higher mortality in girls compared with vaccinated boys. Anesthetists know very well that females respond differently to anesthesia than males, and very often this difference is explained by the hormonal differences between the two genders. With the findings in the vaccination program, girls respond differently from boys. I became curious about anesthesia in small children. Do girls and boys respond differ in their response to anesthesia analog to the findings in adults? So again, this question was the background for choosing the first title, Anaesthesia in Women. However, I very soon became disappointed about the limited literature about this topic. So already now, I will give the conclusion that there are very few, as far as I know, or no studies or publications specifically dealing with gender differences in anesthesia in neonates and small children. So I will continue with what we know about adults. In the first part of my lecture, I will briefly present some important differences between females and males with respect to physiology, neurology, and pharmacology, and I will summarize and conclude on the known gender differences. And first, the hormonal variability. As mentioned before, in studies reporting differences in anesthesia, many conclusions refer to the hormonal differences between men and women. And this figure illustrates the cyclic release of the female sex hormones, estrogen and progesterone. And luteinizing hormone and follicle stimulating hormone are released from the pituitary during the cycle, but they play, however, a minor role compared to estrogen and progesterone. And many of the gender differences in anesthesia can be explained by the direct or indirect action of the female sex hormones. On this slide, some of the progesterone effects are listed. They provide anxiolysis, hypnosis, analgesia, and they increase the potency of inhalational anesthetics. There are differences in body composition. Females have a lower relative body weight, lower muscle mass, up to 10% higher body fat content, less body water, and it means lower plasma volume. And electrolyte balance and extracellular fluid volume fluctuate during menstrual cycle. And this picture, it illustrates the differences in body composition in the perfect male and female body. It's an old picture. Today I maybe could present a Barbie doll and Batman, that's the same figures. Cardiovascular differences. Men and women are born with the same number of myocytes, but cardiac mass increases more in men. And despite this, younger women have better diastolic function and larger ejection fraction compared with men. Resting heart rate is higher and varies during menstrual cycle. And women have a lower blood pressure up to 10 millimeter mercury. And this changes after menopause. And by the age of 70 years, women's blood pressure exceeds that of men. And estrogen contributes to the lower blood pressure. It causes vasodilation via increased nitric oxide secretion. And progesterone has also a lowering effect on blood pressure. Then we have respiratory differences. Women have smaller lung volume and smaller diffusion surfaces. Their ventilatory response to hypercapnia, exercise and hypoxia is less compared with men. And finally, some renal and metabolic differences. Glomerular filtration rate and renal blood flow are lower in women, but when accounted for body weight, there's no major differences for men in renal function. And metabolic rate is lower due to smaller body size as a women's. And metabolism fluctuates with states of menstrual cycle because progesterone stimulates metabolism and body temperature also fluctuates during menstrual cycle. That's almost basic knowledge. Yes. There are gender differences in hepatic. Oh, sorry, it was too early. I'll first talk about pharmacokinetic differences. Body size, muscle fat, and total body water composition differ between males and females, as I told you before. The volume of distribution for water-soluble drugs is lower in women, and it means that lower doses of water-soluble drugs are needed to produce equivalent effect to that in men. For example, the muscle relaxants, bicaronium, pancuronium, rocuronium. And in contrast, the volume of distribution for lipid-soluble drugs is higher in women. And it's relevant for benzodiazepines, for diazepam and midazolam, and also for propofol. So reduced sensitivity in women means that they require higher doses of propofol and midazolam to lose consciousness. Hepatic enzyme activity is a clinically important topic in relation to gender differences in anesthesia. However, I will jump over this very large topic with a few summarizing statements. There are gender differences in hepatic blood flow, in hepatic blood flow, but it's not an important factor in relation to drug metabolism. Differences in hepatic enzyme activity is mainly responsible for the differences in hepatic metabolism, or therefore clearance of a drug. So before I continue with neurological gender differences, I will briefly summarize some of the well-described gender differences in anesthesia in adults. I have listed the differences between females and males here. There are differences in sensitivity, shorter time to eye opening and higher degree of postoperative nausea, vomiting, sore throat, postoperative pain, high degree of headache, baggage, hospital stay, patient satisfaction, and postoperative outcome. So altogether, it's bad to be a woman in this relation. And the differences are most pronounced in adults, less in children and elderly. And this is the background for giving hormones the major role. I will recommend those of you who are interested in this topic about gender differences in anesthesia to read this excellent review article from ACTA. This is an ACTA lecture, but this is from ACTA. It's from 2003, but it's still highly relevant. It's from a Norwegian group from Bergen. So I'll give some summary and conclusion. And that's what we know already. Women recover faster from general anesthesia, and they have higher postoperative sequelae, such as nausea and vomiting, sore throat, headache, and backache. And they also have worse recovery and outcome following some types of major surgery. Now I will turn. I'll continue with the leading hypothesis to explain gender differences in anesthesia involves the hormonal differences between women and men. However, is gender dependence just a question about hormone levels? So now I will turn to the brain. There has always been jokes about differences between female and male brains. The male brain is bigger than the female brain and so on. Yes, male and female brains are different from the beginning, but maybe in another way than illustrated here. The brain is the main target of anesthesia and anesthetics. We know a lot about what happens in the developing brain. We know it from animal studies, we know it from postmortem studies, and some clinical studies with the advanced imaging techniques. The brain is dimorph. Sexual differentiation begins in the womb and it continues until early adulthood. It's triggered by the exposure of intrauterine testosterone, progesterone, and estrogen, and of course the sex chromosome genes. And many gender differences in brain structure, in volume, and function are present from birth and throughout life. Yes. And this is, with this slide, I will illustrate the difference between behavior, the difference between males and females in behavior. You have a mission, visit the shopping center and buy one bottle of milk and two sodas. And the red line is a woman going into a shopping center and she returns again. And the male, he goes directly to the supermarket and he buys the milk and the sodas. And the result, total price for the female, 159 euros, and for the man, 2.2 euros. So that's the way it is, it's quite clear. Talking about the brain and the brain as main target of anesthetics, it's highly relevant to focus on children. And very few issues in pediatric anesthesia have caused so much concern as a number of animal studies have shown that exposure to anesthesia during a vulnerable period of brain development have harmful effects later in life. And there are some epidemiological cohort studies of neonates and small children undergoing anesthesia early in life, but so far, just to conclude, there's no scientific evidence for a harmful effect of early anesthesia. It's to summarize it. But this topic was discussed in an editorial in ACTA last year, and in my opinion, a very excellent editorial, and where the conclusion was no evidence of negative effects of anesthesia in early life. However, in these large cohort studies, they didn't look at gender differences, whether differences between boys and girls, and it should be possible. I'll go to a conclusion. There is, surprisingly for me at least, a huge knowledge gap about gender differences in children's response to anesthesia. We know a lot about adults and anesthesia. We know that males and females are physiologically different in their response to anesthetic agents, and the brain is the main target of anesthesia. The brain is sexually dimorphic from birth and throughout life, and gender has a major impact on the influence of anesthesia in the brain. And in adults, sex differences are apparent in the induction phase, during maintenance and recovery phases of general anesthesia. It's most pronounced in adults, and puberty exacerbates the differences supporting the role of hormones. I have some concerns. If you read the literature, females are often excluded from both basic and clinical research because of breeding, pregnancy, and hormonal changes. And even in animal studies, males are often preferred. And the exclusion of females in anesthesia-related research leaves a knowledge gap in the literature. And I think this knowledge gap is even worse in other specialties such as cardiology and endocrinology. So this was the first part of my lecture. Now I'll go to women in anesthesia. And looking back on more than 30 years in anesthesia, this specialty has undergone an amazing development in many aspects. And I will, in the following, I'll focus on the academic aspects of women in anesthesia. I was the first female professor in anesthesia in Denmark when I became full professor at Aarhus University Hospital in 1995, 22 years ago. In Scandinavia, there was only one other female professor, and that was my Elin Koller in Bergen. None females in Sweden, Iceland, and Finland, as far as I know. And Aarhus University Hospital is the biggest hospital in Denmark. And in 95, I had a company by one other female professor at the in the hospital. She was professor in clinical biochemistry. And at that time, there was an increasing attention on gender inequality in the academic world. And my female colleague and I, we were very busy. We were asked about memberships of boards, panels, research councils, evaluation committees, etc. It was a very busy time. But it was mandatory that there should be at least one female representative in all these organs. So we were busy among all the men. Our talking about women in academic anesthesia, I am very happy to present this figure. It shows the number of Danish anesthetists having positions as professors. Most of them in anesthesia, but there are also two in acute medicine or emergency medicine, and two in training, teaching and education. And this figure illustrates, I think, very nicely the development in academic anesthesia in Denmark during a 22-year period from 1995 up till today. In 1995, the specialty had a low, I think, academic status compared with other specialties. It's illustrated by only two full professorships in 1995. And then there is a very steep increase in the number of professors during the last few years, and it illustrates a high research activity in our specialty. And talking about women in anesthesia, there is now, at least in Denmark, an overweight of female professors. There is much attention, or much more attention on gender equality in Sweden than in Denmark, and it may be a little bit problematic to show this figure in Sweden with this female dominance. But however, so far there have not been any protesters in Denmark against this dominance. This was a happy message about women in anesthesia. Now, in the following, I will give a few examples illustrating that gender equality in science is still far, far away, not only in Denmark, but also in Scandinavia. This figure shows the proportion of female full professors by main fields in science in Denmark, in Norway, in the middle, the light, and in Denmark and Sweden and in Norway. And if we look at medical sciences, the proportion of female professorships in Denmark is very low. It's only around 15%. It's much higher in Sweden, and even in Norway it's higher. And as I mentioned before, Sweden has a very active policy regarding gender differences in science and about gender equality in science. And I think that the result of this policy may be reflected in this figure showing medical sciences, the female proportion. Returning to anesthesia, this figure shows the proportion of female and male first authors in original papers published in British Journal of Anesthesia in 2011. And senior authors here are last authors, and in practice it will very often be the main supervisor for the first author. And the percentage of male first authors, as you can see, is much, much higher than the percentage of female authors. It's only 30% compared with 70%. And most publications with females as first authors have a male senior author or last author. This is the red area. And males as first and last or senior authors constitute the largest part of this diagram. That's a green area. So a dominance of males as first authors and last authors, or senior authors. Gender inequality seems to be present at all levels in the scientific world. I will mention another area where females are severely underrepresented. In this publication, the gender representation in guideline boards was studied. It was clinical practice guidelines related to a number of different specialties. And as you can see, female physicians comprised only 25% of all authors. And regarding guidelines for critical care medicine, only 13% of the authors were females. And worst case, there were no females in the boards developing the sepsis 3 definitions and the ARDS definitions. In the same paper, the authors looked at the gender proportion in editorial boards, such as an ACTA. And the same pattern was found, I'll not show the results, but the same pattern was found in editorial board members in journals in anesthesiology, with a female proportion of only 15%. And in Journal of Critical Care Medicine, the proportion of female was even lower. It was only 70%. And I think if we look at the editorial board in ACTA Anaesthesiologica, it's not far away from these figures. Yeah. I will not discuss the background for this female underrepresentation in editorial board and guideline board. I'll just mention that the authors of this publication propose a number of proactive strategies to ensure gender parity within critical care medicine. There is Jon Lorke from Oslo was co-author in this publication, and he told me a very interesting story about the background for this publication, but I'll not go into details with that now. Instead, I will continue with a story from my professional life as female professor. After 10 years as professor in Aarhus, I received a letter from the Ministry of Science. It's in Danish. I have translated it to English. I'm considering recommending to Her Majesty the Queen's Cabinet Secretary that you are awarded the Knight's Cross of the Order of Dannebrog. And this requires you are not subject to any pending or spent criminal convictions, which would make such an award untenable. So, as I had no previous or ongoing criminal activities in my curriculum vitae, I received by post a small box with this Order of Dannebrog from the Queen Margrethe den Anden of Denmark, and it's here. You can see it. Wow. And a few days later, I went to the Queen's Castle in Copenhagen, where I was in the audience of the Queen, and I thanked her for the order and told her a little bit about my research, and it took a few minutes. At the castle, I met two of my orthopedic colleagues from Aarhus. They were also awarded the Order of Dannebrog. They deserved it because they had successfully operated on the Queen, given her a new hip or a new knee, I don't remember. But why did I receive this order? Yes, very importantly, I had not committed any crimes. That's one part. But at that time, there were very few female professors at the university, in the faculty, as I told before. And every year, the faculty should nominate candidates for this order. And they should nominate at least one female professor. So I was lucky. That's the reason for this. Now I will talk about the woman in anesthesia. This is not my mother. Who is it? Yes. Yeah. This is Virginia Apgar. And I was a medical student when she passed away, so I have never seen or have never met her. She was the first female full professor at Columbia University in New York. And as you know, she introduced the Apgar score, the first standardized method for assessing the health of newborn babies. And a few words about her life. She graduated in 1933, and she completed a surgical residence in 1937. But her chief, a surgeon, convinced her to go into anesthesia because there was a lack of well-qualified anesthetists at that time. So she went into anesthesia, and she had training with Rolf Waters and with Ernest Rovenstein. The first anesthetic department in the States. And both doctors are famous pioneers in American anesthesia. And she went back to Columbia University in 1938 as director of the division and as attending anesthetist. And it was a very hard time for her. She had troubles with recruiting physicians, and surgeons did not accept anesthetists as equals. Have we heard that before? Low pay for the less respected specialty, and she was the only staff member until mid-40s. And finally, in 46, anesthesia became a medical specialty, and her department became an academic department with her as full professor in 59. But this story about anesthesia in the States, I think, is very similar to the story about anesthesia in Scandinavian. As I told you before, she introduced the Apgar score. She left after 10 years in anesthesia. She left anesthesia. She earned a Master of Public Health degree. She was very active outside in other areas of medicine. She advocated for vaccination to prevent mother-to-child transfusion of of rubella because there was a big a pandemic in 64, 65. And she promoted rhesus testing of women to identify women at risk for transfusion or antibodies across placenta. She was very, very active. But she was had also a very active social life. She played very well a violin, and together with a friend, she built her own violin, a viola, and a cello marker. She was an enthusiastic gardener. She enjoyed fly fishing, golfing, and stamp collection. And she took flying lessons when she was in the mid-50s. Yes. And of course, she received a lot of honors. I have mentioned some of them there, but as you can see, she was honored by the ASA, American Society of Anaesthesiology, in 66, and also again in 1973. And she was elected as Woman of the Year in Science in 1973. An amazing woman. And after her death, she was also honored. She was honored by a stamp, the US Postal Stamp Service. She was honored by a 20-cent Great American Series stamp. This series was started in 1980, and it ran until 1999. And altogether, 63 persons were honored with a stamp, among them two presidents, Thomas Jefferson and Henry Truman, and also the composer Igor Stravinsky was awarded. And 15 of the 63 persons were women. It means 24%. Here is the stamp. Virginia Apgar fought for the specialty anesthesia, and she met a lot of problems, especially in her early career. However, she was never active in organized women's movements as liberation, feminism, and sexism, and so on. She said that women are liberated the first the time they leave the womb. And she also said that being female has not imposed significant limitations on my medical career. So, of course, it's not an opportunity, but I would like to give Virginia Woolf my Order of Dannebrog because she deserved it. Thank you.